that doesn't impact our friendship at all. And I think that I want to thank you for your wonderful presentation. I want to start out with sort of an anecdote with regard to the subject of textual forgeries and my introduction to it. And I'll make sure that my presentation doesn't go longer than the allotted time. But I think it's useful and instructive to sort of consider the broader context of any inscription that appears on the antiquities market rather than found on some sort of a scientific expedition. It was November of 97 that I went to the ASOR meeting, presented a paper on the laboratory test, scanning electron microscopic tests using an EDS of the Musaif ostraca, two ostraca that had been published by some very fine scholars. And Pierre Bourdreuil was in the audience, and he heard my presentation about the laboratory tests. And at that point, I'd simply reported on the laboratory tests. The laboratory tests were done by the Microfocus OI laboratory and by the McCrone laboratory, two very fine laboratories. They had, in essence, authenticated these pieces. And so in NEA in 1998, I did a synopsis of those presentations, those laboratory tests. So in essence, I'd seen the laboratory tests. The ostrich had already been published. I did a presentation on those laboratory tests. Pierre Bourdreuil saw it, liked it very much, said, can you publish this in NEA? And I said, sure, and I did. Fast forward now to August of 98, and I'm in Joseph Neves' home on Hova Bay Street. And he was very gracious and very helpful. And then he sat me down and said, I want to talk about those laboratory tests. And as you probably will recall, Neves and Israel Afal wrote an article in IEJ and said the Musaif ostraca are forgeries. Neves wanted to talk about the laboratory tests because he wanted to sort of hear my musings. And so I told him that I believe that the laboratory tests demonstrated that these pieces were actually authentic, ancient ostraca, and quite important. He was pleasant, and he was extraordinarily helpful to me at that point. I was in the middle of my dissertation research, but he wasn't convinced at all. And I spent the next year looking carefully at all of the excavated ostraca, old Hebrew ostraca. And then the night before, and I hadn't looked at the photos of the Musaif ostraca for some time, actually, not during the entirety of my dissertation research, so didn't look at them after that ASOR presentation in 97, really, and Navan, I didn't look at them in his home that day. But I did, the night before my defense of my dissertation, decided that my dissertation on old Hebrew paleography based only on excavated materials, I thought that it may be that the subject of the Musaif ostraca would come up in my defense. And so I looked at them the night before my defense, and it was very clear to me that the aberrations present in those inscriptions were serious, and that there was no way that those were actually authentic. So, but I thought, it's not going to probably come up in my defense tomorrow. And so I went into the defense, and five people were there, and I presented my dissertation. And then at the end, my Dr. Fatter slid two photographs across the table of the Musaif ostraca. And he said, how does this correspond with the things that you've said in your dissertation? And I said, they don't. And my Dr. Fatter was puzzled at that point and said, what do you mean? I said, these are modern forgeries. He was floored at that point. And then there was some discussion, and then I passed. And I was grateful for that. Navedo was a master at discerning forgeries, epigraphic forgeries. There are a number of reasons for that. I think, in particular, his eye was peerless. I absolutely believe that. And I learned from that, those incidents with Nava, to be particularly careful about things with regard to inscriptions from the market. I want to say a few more words before I begin to talk about the Jerusalem papyrus, just to set the broader context of things. Textual forgeries, especially pious ones, this is a very, very old profession. We can actually go back to Mesopotamia, to the Manishtushu inscriptions, and those are pious textual forgeries, written almost 2,000 years after the purported date. The famine stela from Egypt is the same thing. W.M.L. DeVetta argued the same thing with regard to the Book of Deuteronomy. That may or may not be something that you find convincing. That's fine. But it's been argued, and there's a fairly decent consensus in the field, as all of you know, that that is plausible at the very least. With regard to the New Testament, the pastoral epistles of 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus are often argued to be textual forgeries as well. We can move into the Middle Ages with the donation of Constantine and Lorenzo Valla's debunking of that, another pious textual forgery. We can move into things even further, such as the Shapira forgeries of the mid to late 1800s. We can talk actually as well about Schlottmann's defense in ZDPV on numerous occasions of the authenticity of those inscriptions. He put his reputation on the line. He was a fine, fine scholar, Semitist, with really few peers in terms of philology. But as Clermont Ganeau had argued, those were blazing forgeries. All of them were blazing forgeries. And today, if you look at them, you go to the Rockefeller, the Hebrew U, the Israel Museum, they wouldn't fool a first-year student, but they fooled people in the late 1800s. We could move forward to the very late 1800s, early 1900s, and the Greek inscription that was found near the Temple Mount, and the fact that there was a forgery that appeared not long after that, in essence attempting to imitate that piece. We could move forward further still to the Musaif Ostraca, Jehoash inscription, various other pieces that have been forged. So the first thing that I want to say as I begin is that there have long been some very fine forgers in the history of scholarship. They read our articles these days. They attend our meetings, I think that at times, and that was even the case in the days of Shapira. So let's now move into this piece in particular, the Jerusalem Papyrus. During October 2016, this papyrus mentioning Jerusalem and purportedly hailing from the 7th century BCE was published and by Professor Ahituv, Klein, and Gnor. The letters on the papyrus are those of the old Hebrew script. They're written in black ink. The papyrus was not discovered on a scientific excavation, but was rather seized by the Israeli authorities after it had circulated on the antiquities market for a time. And indeed, during the academic year 2013-2014, I was shown a very high resolution image of that very inscription by an antiquities dealer, hoping, I suppose, that I would authenticate it or at least be interested in it. The authors of the Editio Princeps were careful and very thorough, and in a number of ways, the Editio Princeps of the Jerusalem Papyrus should be considered a model publication. You've already heard a very fine presentation about the proposed readings. I want to say first and foremost that I wish that I could say that this piece is indeed authentic. I want to set the broader context as well about it. With regard to the word Jerusalem, indeed, in 1963, Nava published an article on the Kirbet Beit Lei inscriptions and the fact that Jerusalem occurred there. So we have the word Jerusalem attested epigraphically, just as Professor Ahituv has noted. We have the word king, of course, attested in various inscriptions. Wine, we have attested as well. The medium, as Professor Ahituv has noted, is rare but not unique, with the Murabaat papyrus being a flagship example. Nevertheless, this inscription, though it uses words such as king and Jerusalem, and these words are attested in the epigraphic record, this inscription isn't something that I would consider particularly mundane at all. In fact, of all of the first temple inscriptions that we have from scientific expeditions, we have no other inscription. We have no inscription from a scientific archaeological expedition which mentions both Jerusalem and king. So it's striking. Out of the hundreds and hundreds of inscriptions that we have, we don't have that. Some of you may be thinking, wait, in Lachish 6, we have that. In the fourth line of Lachish 6, we definitely have the word king. In the 10th line, we have some who propose the reading Jerusalem. The problem with that is that it's probably not there. Tur Sinai, who did the Edition of Princeps, actually just read the very first word of that line, Kazot, left it at that, said he couldn't read any more of it. André Lemaire did the most authoritative recent edition of the Lachish Ostraca, and he said the traces don't fit the word Jerusalem. It's not there. Therefore, one of the things that I would emphasize is that this papyrus is rather striking because it has both the word king and the word Jerusalem. We don't have that in any inscription that I know of from a scientific expedition. So this isn't a mundane inscription in terms of the content at all, precisely the reverse. And one of the things that forgers know is the fact that if an inscription has sensational content, two things happen. One is the price that it will bring in the market dramatically increases, and the other thing is that there's almost a direct correlation in the opposite direction with regard to critical thinking. That is to say, the more sensational the text, the more people wish for it to be true. And I think we always have to factor that into the equation. That was the case with the Musaif Ostraca. It was the case with the Jehoash inscription. It's the case with pieces such as the ivory pomegranate, I believe, as well. Now let's continue with this papyrus, reflecting on it for a moment. The carbon date of the papyrus is at some level important and at some level absolutely useless. Let me explain. As I noted, in 2003, forgers, in an article, first of my articles on the subject of forgery, it's not so difficult for a forger to find access to pottery, which can be used as the basis for ostraca, stone that can be used for monumental inscriptions of some sort, or things such as papyrus and vellum. That's definitely the case now. No forger worth his salt would actually attempt to forge a modern inscription on modern papyrus. That's just stupid. And it just doesn't happen very often. I'll talk about a counterexample in just a moment. But it's not the sort of thing that a savvy forger these days would do. Rather, a forger would find an antiquities market, and it can be found. You can find it now, should you so desire, online. You can find papyrus. And if you're good, you can even find papyrus that dates to about the time that you wish for your forged inscription to be dated to. So the medium doesn't mean very much at all. And we need to simply put that out there as something that's just a fact of modern epigraphic life. And so that's the first thing that I would mention with regard to the carbon date. It doesn't necessarily prove anything. Any forger worth his salt would find a piece of ancient papyrus and use that as the medium, just as any forger today would use a potsherd from the Iron Age if you wish to write, compose an ostracon. And with regard to the carbon date that is given, one of the things that I emphasized very rapidly, and the Editio Princeps does a nice job with this, but some of the early press reports suggested that the papyrus was carbon dated to the 7th century and that the script was dated to the 7th century as well. One of the problems with that is that, as probably everybody in the room knows, with regard to carbon dates, there's always a plus or minus. It's just the way that it works. And I was fascinated by the fact that in the press reports, there wasn't reference to a plus or minus date, really. This papyrus, though, and it's in the Edition of Print Cups, and I'm grateful for that, the plus or minus date, or the carbon date, the calibrated date, is 2460 BP, plus or minus 71 years. That date's striking because it falls in the Hallstatt Plateau. Basically, what that means is that for carbon dates that date to about that time period, you, regardless of whatever the carbon date is, you basically have a span from 400 to 800 BCE for that piece. In other words, that's just the way that it works. For carbon dates that come about 2450 BP, and this one came at 2460 BP, you can't actually say that that puts that piece of papyrus in the 7th century. Again, that's the Hallstatt Plateau, and what we know is that basically for anything that falls in that range, you actually have to allow 400 years. Why is that important? Someone might say to me, so what? The 7th century falls within that range. Sure. Here's the deal. There were people who argued, not in the Edition of Print Cups, but there were people who argued that the correspondence of the carbon date, 7th century, with the paleographic dating, 7th century, basically was a demonstration of the authenticity of this piece. The problem with that is that the carbon date actually isn't 7th century necessarily at all. It's somewhere between 400 and 800. And that's just the way that it is. So factor that in to the way that we wish to understand this. So I wish for this piece to be authentic. But the point is, we have to be cautious about any piece that comes on the market. The second thing that I would say is that with regard to the ink actually wasn't tested. That's too bad. I think that it should have been. Now, I've argued in print that ink can be faked. I don't think that it's so difficult. I've thrown away, and I haven't excavated very much, but I've thrown away a fair amount of carbonized remains, beams, and that sort of thing. Bagged and tagged some, thrown the rest of the away. If you actually have carbonized remains, ink, black ink, was made from carbon. You can actually manufacture your own right now, today, quite readily. You can take a little bit of iron if you wish, and you can take some carbonized remains from an excavation, maybe just mention to a dealer that you wish for it, and you can actually have carbon-based ink that'll actually, if tested with a carbon-14 test, will actually date to antiquity. And that's fascinating as well. I actually think that there are other ways to get ink as well. So for example, you could buy an ostracon that had some poor inscription on it, wasn't very sensational. Scrape that ink off, mix it with a little water, and make your own. Write another inscription quite readily. After I mentioned these things in print, Yuval Gorin wrote to me very rapidly, and he said, actually, it's even easier than you're thinking. He said, if you really want to do this, all you need to do is take a pot that's been used in antiquity, fired in antiquity, and then used over a fire, a cooking pot, scrape some of that carbon from the fire, and you've got yourself a pretty nice carbon-based resin, even, that you can use. So, the ink wasn't tested in this case. I hope that it is tested at some point. But even if that were done, that doesn't necessarily prove the antiquity of it, because ink can be faked. You may very well be thinking, will anybody actually go to such lengths? And I would say to you, are you serious? Of course people will go to those lengths. Let me remind you of a little bit of the history here. The ivory pomegranate sold in the late 1970s, early 1980s. I think it was the 80s when it was sold to the Israel Museum, or a donor gave the money for the purchase of it. Sold for $550,000 then. That's a fair amount of motivation. The Jehoash inscription was offered, I've heard from good sources, for a couple million dollars to the Israel Museum. By the way, the first time I saw that thing, I said, it's a forgery. And I drafted an email right away to Frank Cross and Joseph Nave with my paleographic concerns with regard to the Jehoash inscription. Nave wrote me back. Cross wrote me back right away as well, but Nave was just like that. He wrote me back and he said, yeah, it's a forgery. He said, I saw it about a year ago. I was evaluating it. The Israel Museum was interested in purchasing it, and I told them to pass on it. It was a forgery. So he said, yeah, it's a forgery. That's substantial motivation. So when you're asking yourself, would someone actually go online and buy a papyrus, a blank papyrus, or a piece of a papyrus which has a blank area, and then make some ink and write on it? Sure, there are substantial motivations for doing that. And I should also mention that all the way back to the Lachish ostrich, and maybe even earlier than that, there's been laboratory testing of ink. So if you look at the Edition of Print Cups of the Lachish ostrich, 1938, they actually laboratory tested the ink. So it's not as if the laboratory testing of ink is something that's a modern phenomenon. We can do it better now, right? You can take a scanning electron microscope and you can actually know the chemical composition of inks with absolute precision. They couldn't do that in 1938, but they were still testing it then. And they knew that it was carbon-based, and they knew that it was mixed in part with iron, at least at times. And so keep that in mind. Now let's continue to move on with regard to this papyrus. So the first thing that I want to emphasize is that the medium, the antiquity of the medium, means virtually nothing with regard to the authenticity of a piece, because you can actually acquire media, whether it's a potsherd or a dressed stone, or a piece of vellum or a piece of papyrus quite readily on the antiquities market. You can actually manufacture ink. That too is not so difficult. And you want to use Photoshop for creating some really fine letters. This too is now possible, yes? Let's talk more about this piece though, and one of the problems with it. The words Nevelim or Nevelim Yayin. That's a striking juxtaposition. It's difficult to view that any other way, the relationship between those two words, other than being some sort of a construct relationship. And you can, of course, go to Juon or Walt Keen O'Connor or Gazanius Couch Cowley, and of course, or you can go to Lambden for that matter. And of course, as everybody in the room knows, when we have a construct relationship in a masculine plural or a dual plural, we actually don't have the mame. We actually get nivle yayin. That's actually what we get. And we get that in 1 Samuel 25:18 with regard to this very phrase. We get nivle yayin. So we don't have that on the papyrus. We do have it attested in the Bible. It's striking that we don't have the proper construct form, therefore, on this papyrus. We also get it in Job 38:37 with a different nomen rectum, but in any case, we have Nivle Shemayim in Job 38:37. Lamentations 4:2, we have Nivle Haras. So the point is, we actually have the construct form of that word. And we also know from our understanding of the Semitic languages, whether it's Phoenician, Hebrew, Aramaic, etc., that the masculine plural and the masculine dual eliminate the mame. We just, that's the way that it works. And so it's rather fascinating that we don't have that on this papyrus. You may say, well, I can account for that in some fashion. Fascinating, but problematic at some level. It's rather strained. I can account for its presence there quite nicely. In modern Hebrew, of course, the construct isn't used so much. And in fact, if someone were saying this today, they might very well say something such as Nevelim Shel Yayin. Right, in modern Hebrew, that's perhaps a way you could say this. I think that may very well be what happened in this case. I think this is a modern forgery, and I think that it's something such as that that accounts for this. You may very well say there are a few instances when we don't get when we get a main. You may say, well, it's a frozen form of some sort. And I'd respond by saying, well, it's strange that we don't get the frozen form with Nivlei Yayin when it shows up in the Bible, or Nivlei Shemayim, or Nivlei Haras. So if it's a frozen form, that's a very strained argument, very difficult to make, difficult argument to make. You might suggest that it's some sort of mimation. Again, that's a difficult argument to make for its preservation or for the retention of the mame there, when a normal construct form, dual or plural, would eliminate it. There are a few instances when we have units of weight and measure when we actually get, a few instances, especially in kings, when we'll get a dual that actually doesn't, a dual nomen regens, in which we don't get the expected construct form. In all of those cases, and there aren't many, we have a unit of measure, kikar, seah. We don't have that here, I don't think, with Neville. In other words, I don't think of that as a precise unit of measure. And in any case, it's sort of strained to resort to rare exceptions to account for something in a papyrus from the antiquities market. I'd also want to mention that restorations are rarely certain. I did Dead Sea Scrolls with Kyle McCarter and also with Larry Schiffman. And I remember one day when I was reading Sarek Yahad with him, the class was. It wasn't just me, fortunately. That would be terribly intimidating. And there was a restoration. Someone had proposed a restoration. And so I was a doctoral student and wanted to note that I'd looked into that restoration. And Schiffman just said, I don't talk about restorations. What's the point? It's a restoration. It's pretty good logic, and I've tried to put that into play or place in my own life. And I generally just don't talk about restorations. One of the things that I would mention, and restoring an aleph, it's one, as Professor Ahitub has mentioned, it's one of several options. I don't know that we can actually settle on any. And I would really love for this papyrus to actually tell us something about the status of women in the 7th century in Judah. But the problem is, it's a restoration. And so any attempt to read something into gender in the 7th century is based on a restoration. And I employ Schiffman's principle with regard to restorations. Nadav Natman has actually mentioned something else to me. I'll go ahead and read his thoughts. I'm not wedded to them or committed to them, but I think that they are interesting. He's mentioned as a hypothetical the following. He says, it may very well be that the modern forger, his words, was surprised to discover that the text was restored the handmaid of the king. And Nadav Naaman says this, the forger rather was assuming that it would be restored as Adamat Hamelik, PN, supervisor, sort of understood, of the crown land, since that is the current term for crown land in modern Hebrew. He's also noted that the authors of the Editio Princeps did consider this restoration, as Professor Ahituf has also today mentioned it. But Nadav Naaman went on to note that the best known crown land in the Jordan Valley is that of Jericho, well known in the Hasmonean and Roman periods. From the very few villages referred to in the Bible in this area, the forger selected Na'arat, referred to in Joshua 16:7, thereby creating an attractive continuity between the reality of the first and second temple periods. To this note from Nadav Naaman, a personal communication, Israel Finkelstein, added this. He's emphasized that the forger would have readily known that in Hasmonean Herodian times, there were vines in the area of Jericho, so he didn't hesitate to make that connection. So that's something that has been proposed with regard to it. I want to sort of mention a few things. I want to mention that as I sort of conclude during circa 10 minutes. Do I have circa 10 minutes left? Yeah, okay. And one of the things that I would want to mention is that one of the most fascinating cases of forgery in the second half of the 20th century one of the most interesting cases was the Hebron Philistine forgeries. You may remember those. 1971, Mendenhall actually, with Brownlee, does a presentation at the SBL meeting on these fascinating new inscriptions. And Frank Cross says, they look like these are, this looks like something that's based on the Siloam Tunnel inscription. Mendenhall was really displeased. Brownlee dropped it at that point, and Mendenhall persisted, a great scholar in many ways. He persisted, and he noted that there had been carbon 14 tests, and they did yield a modern date, but he attributed that to the variable storage and handling practices. And he also noted, remember this is 1970-71, that there were computer analyses that had been done, and about 42 out of 67 morphemes had been located in this inscription. Mendenhall went on to state this: it's curious that the only scholars who were convinced of the authenticity of these inscriptions are those who worked seriously with the original documents. A trenchant comment. He intended that to be, no doubt. Mendenhall knew that there were some scholars who were suggesting that scholars had actually forged these inscriptions not long before their putative discovery. Of course, the antiquities dealers had stories about precisely where these hailed from Hebron. They could account for it. I would also mention in this connection that antiquities dealers and pillagers are probably not always the most reliable sources of information. At least from my perspective, this is a decent modus operandi to question that sort of thing. Mendenhall, though, persisted, and he said this: those who perpetuate the rumors have the obligation of forgery, have the obligation of common decency to produce the evidence concerning these alleged forgeries. That was a jab at Frank Moore Cross. Cross didn't take him up in print. For Cross, it was a fait accompli. These were modern forgeries. A few years later, Joseph Navet picked up the gauntlet and actually wrote an article, published it in Basor, entitled Some Recent Forgeries. And Navet demonstrated, some of you will remember the article, that these were indeed modern forgeries, and in essence, it was the Siloam Tunnel inscription script, and it was the Siloam Tunnel inscription itself written backwards. And I doubt that the forger would have been able to have dreamed the success that he had with that particular forgery. I suspect that it was a vitz of some sort, but it worked, and quite nicely. Now, I want to use, during the remaining 5 or 6 minutes that I have, to mention a couple of additional things, namely the Gospel of Jesus' wife. By the way, that the Hebron Philistine documents demonstrate that modern forgers are always they're not always careful about using ancient media, right? I think normally they would be. In that case, the forger wasn't, maybe because he wasn't really thinking that people would take him all that seriously. He was wrong in that regard. Mendenhall took him seriously. Fortunately, the great Yossi Navet didn't. The Gospel of Jesus' wife is sort of instructive in this regard, and I want to say a few words about that. Some of you will know, perhaps everybody in the room will know about that. A distinguished professor of Christian history actually published that inscription, King, and she was convinced that it was authentic. She noted that it was written in Sahidic Coptic, some 8 lines, use of black ink, and the article that she published in HTR, Harvard Theological Review, is really a magnum opus in its own right. It is detailed, and in a lot of ways serves as a model publication. And she was careful because she knew that the content was sensational. She read some of the words in Coptic as Jesus said to them, "My wife." She was careful to note that it wasn't a first or second century CE papyrus document that came from a few centuries later. So it had no relevance on the historical Jesus, but had some relevance for the ways in which Christians, at least some Christians, viewed Jesus and the status of women, his relationship with women during the early centuries of the Common Era. She wanted to be careful, though, so she brought in papyrologists and linguists. Roger Bagnall was brought in. Ariel Shisha Halevi was brought in as well. She has stated that they provided significant contributions to her publication. She also brought in Noreen Touras of Harvard's Department of Human Evolutionary Biology to do carbon-14 tests. Greg Hodgins of the NSF Arizona AMS Laboratory, where he was brought in as well. And the carbon dates demonstrated that the papyrus was actually ancient. But she wanted to be particularly careful, so she brought in some people from MIT, and they actually did Fourier transform infrared microspectroscopy, and they analyzed it, and they determined that it was entirely keeping, the results were entirely keeping with the authenticity and the antiquity of this piece. But she wanted to be even more careful than that. And so she had some micro-Raman spectroscopy done as well. And the analysis of the ink was done. And the results were these. The authors of the study of the ink said, we find no evidence for any constituents of ink or types of ink other than carbon black. And they considered it to be consistent with antiquity. So she had the papyrus analyzed. She had the ink analyzed, and everything looked very good in many ways. And so you can actually go on HTR's website and see legions, really, of laboratory tests that were performed. She knew that some people were suggesting that it was not authentic. And there were some orthographic problems, and there were some paleographic problems. She basically argued that these were not all that significant and there were ways to account for these. And she argued that the piece was indeed authentic. Leo Dupuit actually argued in the same issue of HTR that it was a modern forgery. And she wrote an article responding to him saying, no, it's not a forgery. And then a very savvy journalist became involved, Ariel Sabar, you know the story, and he wrote an article in 2016, and he said, look, it's a modern forgery. And he knew that because he actually carefully investigated the stories from the dealers and the owner, and it didn't match up, the facts weren't correct. King had believed the things that those fine dealers and owners had told her. Maybe they believed him, maybe they didn't, I have no idea. But after King read Ariel Sabar's article, she said, King said, yeah, sorry, it is a modern forgery. I think that forgers are on the verge of being able to commit the perfect crime, actually. I think that they're I have an article that I've wanted to write for a while, and it may be that if I don't write it fairly soon, it's going to be too late. But I want to entitle the article, The Future Perfect Forgery. Punning on the tense. Thanks. There aren't a lot of groups where that joke will work, and didn't work quite as well as I thought it might here, even. In any case, I think we're approaching the time when people can actually produce forgeries that are not actually detectable. And there's substantial motivation for that in the art market. This occurs all the time, right? And in the epigraphic market, it does as well. So what I would say in conclusion with regard to the Jerusalem papyrus is I hope that it's authentic. It is sensational. We have King and Jerusalem on the same piece. That makes it really special. Forgers know that the more special they make something, the more valuable it is, and the more critical capacities of people sort of drop, sort of an inverse proportion, really, to the sensationalism, or potential sensationalism. of a piece. With regard to the papyrus, I'm glad that it was carbon dated, but this means virtually nothing. The ink wasn't tested. I wish that it would have been, but even if so, one can, will good. I'm glad it will be. It should be, but again, that doesn't necessarily prove anything. It's fairly easy to fake ink as well. With regard to the construct form or the absence thereof, you may say, well, I can account for that. Yeah, I can account for it too. Do we want to resort to strained arguments in order to account for something and say that I think that it's authentic and I can account for it? Karen King actually did that with a Jesus wife papyrus and came to regret that. So what I would say is caveat eruditus, right? May the learned beware, because we have some really gifted forgers. Now, I've mentioned that about 25 or 30 years ago. It was either in his Aramaic Dubiosa article or in his Baser article on some recent forged inscriptions. But he mentioned that there were some really gifted forgers, so a new crop, as it were, 25 years ago. And I think that as we publish on things, discuss the facets of modern forgeries, I think with every publication we educate the forgers quite well. That occurred in the time of Shapira. It's clear that the forger of Shapira was reading ZDPV. And yeah, it's sad but true. And I think that the same is true today. Thank you very much.